I think we can start. This afternoon I'll try to speak in English because there is an international presence and international conference of Professor Berova. What I have to say is that I'm here with a double role. From one side as president of the Italian Chemical Society, and since Professor Berova has been appointed as a new fellow of the Italian Chemical Society, I have to give her some documentation and gifts at the same time by the Italian Chemical Society. And from another side, she will deliver after one of the Scrocco colloquia, which are the new series of colloquia made in Pisa in cooperation between the Scuola Normale, the chemistry department of the University of Pisa, and the two CNR institutes, ICOM and IPCF. So that let me start from the first official role as president of the Italian Chemical Society, please. And here, but at the same time, and is not always related to the fellowship of the Italian Chemical Society, there is also the what we call sigillo del presidente, which is difficult to translate. It is something like sigillum by the president, which is delivered personally by the president of the Italian Chemical Society to the most distinguished scientist he thinks, in his personal opinion, deserve this kind of premium. This is really personal. Thank you. And it is not yet finished. On the other side, there is a double gift by the Italian Chemical Society and also by the Scuola Normale Superiore that I'll give you. If you, it is a surprise, you have to open. This is the first one. It's just made by the Italian Chemical Society. The one of the Scuola Normale has a longer history. Okay, that's all from the point of view.
I appreciate, I'm honored and humbled. By the way, I should say that it's very nice in Italy because you also appreciate that the award is given to women. In 2003, I got Pinot medal, gold medal in Torino, and they gave me the scarf, silk scarf, that is one of the best that I like and you wear very often. So, thank you so much.
Well, and now let me go to the second part, which is the Avogadro colloquium, and in this case I have to say something about the CV of Professor Berova. I apologize because I am not the most expert about the activities of Professor Berova present in the audience, but since this was the privilege of the Scuola Normale to host this Avogadro colloquium, On behalf of the organizing committee, the Scuola Normale, I will say a few words about the CV of Nina Berova that most of you know much better than me. Professor Berova is a research professor at the chemistry department of the Columbia University. She received her PhD in chemistry from the University of Sofia, Bulgaria, and became an associate professor at the University of Sofia at the Institute of Organic Chemistry, the Bulgarian Academy of Science in 82. And she has been a recipient of many scholarships during the 1979-87 and a few research fellowships at the Ruhr University in Germany. Starting from 88, she joined the Department of Chemistry of the Columbia University, where she was at first a research professor and starting by 96, I guess, he is professor in the same department. She received several prestigious awards, and in particular the gold medal Piero Pino she mentioned before by the Italian Chemical Society, and a chirality gold medal at the International Symposium on Molecular Chirality in San Diego, U.S. She is editor of the journal Chirality by Wiley, and a special double issue in the journal Chirality was published in 2008 to honor her achievements. And at the American Chemical Society meeting in Washington in 2009, she was given an auto recognition award by the Royal Chemical Society. And in 2011, she was elected as honorary member of the Italian Chemical Society, so that we have a delay of 1 year, but I'm sorry about that, but I hope the Professor Berova could be happy about the 1 year late recognition of her achievements and so on. Her research is focused on organic stereochemistry and chiroptical spectroscopy, and in particular on electron circular dichroism, optical rotational and vibrational CD, and their applications in structural analysis of chiral synthetic compounds and natural products. Her more recent interests include also chiroptical studies and the theoretical analysis of chiral porphyrin-porphyrin interactions on molecular and supramolecular level. In 2000, she was co-editor and co-author of a second edition of monograph Circular Dichroism, Principles and Applications, co-edited by Kenichi Naganishi and R.W. Woody. Since 1998 up to present, she is co-editor of the journal Chirality, as I mentioned before, and she is co-editor with Polavarapu, Nakanishi, Woody of the two-volume monograph Comprehensive Chiroptical Spectroscopy. She has published more than 200 papers, peer-reviewed papers, including review articles and book chapters. As you can see from this very short CV, Professor Berova is a top-level scientist in this field. I have not to add anything because, as I mentioned, I am not the most expert in the audience about her activity. I hope to have become an additional one of her friends in Italy, and I let Professor Berova to start her contribution, their conference about elucidation of molecular and supramolecular chirality by experimental and theoretical chiroptical methods. Please.
Yes? Okay, thank you. All right, so, dear colleague and friends, I'd like to start once again. Thank you for the great honor that Italian Chemical Society has given to me, and also the attention and great opportunity by Scuola Normale to present this lecture and this colloquia. I personally want to thank for attention and attention to my work and evaluation by the president of society, Professor Vincenzo Berone. Thank you so much. I think is for me it's now time to say that all, particularly after I moved to United States in 88, I had a real chance to start quite close and successful collaboration with many Italian scientists, young scientists coming as a postdoctoral fellow or graduate student in Columbia, and I had a chance to work directly, and also to collaborate with my senior colleague from Italy. I have a list at the very end. I hesitated until a few hours whether I should put this first slide and the last slide, but I will mention over the presentation the name, and after that perhaps you will be clear why I have these people shown in red in my acknowledgement slide. I'm particularly impressed with the possibility to have lecture in such beautiful lecture hall, which do not exist in the United States. The people who have visited Columbia know this 309 is nothing to compare with this gorgeous room. Thank you so much for this, giving me this chance. And let's start now, so it will be more go to work. I hope I will give you some overview of the work that has been done in Colombia in the past few years, with the focus of this work that has been in participation with an Italian colleague. Okay, I selected three topics, and you will see over the time. Okay, so this a little bit make me uncomfortable, but I should think that is funny, so maybe it will be fun. Okay, so. So chirality, as we all know, is internal properties of all living organisms, and therefore control of chirality on molecular level is very important for function of all living organisms. But there is another very important fact here. Chirality phenomena are related also to various fields. On the supramolecular and molecular level, chirality is attracting a big interest in the physical, in chemical, physical, biological community. And one reason that we now talk about also the spectroscopy is the fact that the chiral system have a specific response to circular polarized light. Therefore, chiroptical spectroscopy is one a very sensitive way to distinguish chirality in a sense, the configuration and conformation of molecule, either natural products or synthetic materials. So while the method for determining absolute configuration are known in the past as X-ray, chemical correlation, NMR and isotropic methods more recently, we focus on chiroptical methods which has undergone a very long development by semi-empirical method, optical rotation, circular dichroism, electronic and VCD more recently. And we now are witnessing a period, time when the very fast development of the theoretical methods change, revolutionize the way how you look and search about configuration and conformation. Therefore, I think there are three factors that now determine the overall work in field of chirality. First of all, is that the development of a better method for isolation of chiral materials, natural products, are very advanced. The second is that you have technological development of the instrument that you measure the properties more precisely And the third, which is not least important, even though it's one of more important, that you have a big, very progress in theoretical simulation prediction of properties. So this, a lot of work has been written, published in the past few years. I should say that now you can think about measurement of keroptical properties by different methods, more different spectroscopy, and also combined with computational prediction. And I should say that I'm very impressed about the last publication, one of the last of the group of Professor Barone, about this virtual spectrometer, because this is what you have to think in the future, to include a lot of methods, chiroptical methods, in order to determine chirality and chirality of various compounds. So in overall, our means now are much more developed. Therefore, you can undertake more challenging tasks to determine the configuration and conformation of much complicated natural products and synthetic materials. Okay, so now as you can extend these measurements to various regions of the spectra, as electronic circle dichroism, soon perhaps via vacuum UV CD could be also available, electronic CD in the visible absorption, near-infrared, of course, VCD, which is advancing very fast, again, based on these factors that I mentioned. However, you have to be very clear that one of the oldest chiroptical methods, which is electronic circle dichroism, still has a lot of advantages before the other, for example, VCD, because you have here, this is inherent property of electronic CD, that interaction with the circular polarized light can lead to much G factor, much higher G factor, which means that this method could be very sensitive if you have a proper molecule with a chromophore that responds to the circular polarized light. While the current situation with VCD is the lower factor requires a much larger sample amount, which in the current state is a little bit, it's restricted to application to molecules that can be isolated in only in this very small amount. So in order to combine electronic, all these methods, electronic, VCD, optical rotation together, in order to get answer for absolute configuration. We, for example, this is the concept that I think is known to most of the audience. Okay, if you have a natural synthetic compound, the first thing is to measure experimental properties. And after that, there is a long way to get answer for this by comparing with the prediction by theoretical method. So there is here conformational analysis that go this long ways with molecular mechanics and then with with the DFT, this is a force field, comes to Boltzmann weighting and taking also into account the conformation with the environmental factors, and then computing all these properties of single geometries by various methodologies, which include density functional theory, Hartree-Fock, and also coupled cluster. So after that, this calculated average spectra has to be compared with experimental. But the progress has to go in both directions, because if experimental spectra are not measured taking into account solvent properly, in this case, so this means the spectra has to be measured in different conditions, then comparison with calculated spectra cannot be appropriate, because here also the environmental factor has to be accounted for. So, of course, with the past several decades, we use mostly electronic CD and optical rotation. However, BCD, as I said, is advancing, and these three methods currently are the basic method that you use for absolute configuration and conformation in certain cases. Of course, we know very well also that NMR is indispensable in this case, because we have to know relative configuration of complicated samples that contain several stereogenic centers. Fluorescence data are providing also very important clue about the structure, and combination of experimental data with the theoretical ab initio calculation, you can come to some much more reliable assignment of the configuration. However, here I have a question. We have a sample, natural or synthetic. Which method is the best? And I think we view now and see in the literature very often that one method is applied. However, the conclusion is not so unambiguous. So now there exists a trend that perhaps, considering that availability of many spectroscopic techniques and advance of theoretical calculation, and I say again, this virtual spectrometer, when you have the data calculated, take into account all these parameters, you can face the configurational assignment not by one, but several methods concerted work. And therefore, here you have to take a wise decision, which method, one, this, or three, which of these three methods will be the most useful for analysis. Of course, so this is the way how when you have when you look into the particular structure, you may decide. You may decide considering pro and anti of one or the other method, advantages and disadvantages. I would like now to tell you that when it comes, I'll tell you about UV and UV visible chromophore and electronic CD. This is what Lawrence Barron wrote a few years ago. Then optical rotation and CD are used to look into the stereochemistry through the eye of the chromophore. So therefore, if you have the porphyrin that I talk in a moment, or other chromophore, they are not so powerful like porphyrin, we can properly decide in favor of electronic circular dichroism. There are other chromophores here, like diethylenyl alenes I mentioned later on. They also can provide, they can be useful for electronic CD, but even more, they are also useful for study. They can be studied by such sample like optical rotation. So one of the methods that has been over the past years, 40, 45 years, actually in the practical application, is through space chromophoric interaction of excitant coupling. And I should mention here that phenomenon, the excitant coupling is actually phenomenon, it's not the method as only method. So because this excitant coupling provides very characteristic signature in the UV, in BCD spectra, it has been theoretically proven this effect, the interaction through the space long time ago, starting in the 1930s by theoretical study of Kuhn, Kirkwood, Davidoff later, then Steve Mason, And in 1970, this is Harada and Nakanishi actually make this method useful for structural analysis. This is the heart of this approach is that the interaction geometrical orientation of two chromophores, they have allowed transition. Whether they form the positive or negative twist in the space reflect in very characteristic UV and UV band, and also in CD, which leading to split electric transition moment into two terms, negative or positive, first negative and second positive, since the geometry between this transition is negative in the shown here on the slide. So this is mathematical expression of exciton coupling is according to the classical physics and developing DeVoe method. It's reflect this characteristic appearance of electronic circle dichroism spectra, and this, without exaggeration, I should say, this is remain until now the most frequently used approach for calculation. There is a review here which I would like to mention with collaboration with my colleague, the former research in Columbia, Gennaro Pesitelli here in Pisa, and Lorenzo Di Bari. When you try to present this in this review, that's now it's appear to be quite well accepted in society. Usefulness of the method is very clear because here there is in case when there is awareness of conformational factor. So this means that we know the orientation of one chromophore at the stereogenic center and also orientation of the other chromophore. Then this can be done by NMR, orientation from coupling constant, and we know also the orientation of the polarization of electric transition moment. You can predict whether this interaction will be give the bisignate curve based on this preliminary consideration. And from one spectra combined with NMR data, and as I said, other argument, you can make a conclusion for the configuration without even calculation. This is non-empirical because it's based on the solid mathematical correlation between the properties response in the CD and the sign and the geometry of the and the geometry orientation of the chromophore. Of course, there are a lot of details here. You can talk hours about this, how this method has been applied. And here is a case when you have a very rigid molecule, like this is by untrial derivative, when the couplet, so the bisignate curve in this true space interaction is outstanding. It's a very strong CD. Therefore, here there is no doubt about geometry. It's orientation between two long axis chromophore and anthracene are clear, are determined properly. But there are also chromophores that can be used like porphyrin. And in this case, the studies has also clarified the, why the porphyrin can be, I tell you in a moment, or other chromophore that has been more common chromophore like benzoate or naphthoic acid chromophore. In other words, this is a group that can be introduced in otherwise transparent molecule like steroid diol, and when this chromophore is introduced, you make this compound sensitive to circular polarized light, and you can determine, based on the principle of excited chirality, the absolute configuration of stereogenic center carrying hydroxy group. Otherwise, that is impossible. So this means this chromophore here are necessary eyes to determine the stereochemistry of such molecule after some simple chemical derivatization. Porphyrin has been a fascinating chromophore. They are used widely in science, in chemistry, physics. Also, we know that porphyrin, hem porphyrin, properties of hem porphyrin are porphyrin as a prosthetic group in the peptide and are very, very important for biological properties. Porphyrin has a very complicated, relatively complicated electronic structure. They have two electric transition, degenerate transition in the around 400, so that's also Rebent shown here. So therefore, and very strong. In this case, when you have this porphyrin is decorated with a real group, is almost 500,000 extinction coefficient. So that porphyrin are very useful. They have additional properties. They can be also methylated. In this case, they become like artificial receptor. They have, based on their electronic structure, this pi electron system of porphyrin favor them to form inter and intramolecular pi-pi stacking. And of course, excitation energy transfer can be also observed if you have a chiral molecule having porphyrin. But I think the breakthrough is in about 10 years happened when we study in Colombia. Also, Gennaro Pesitelli is here, I mentioned before, he was instrumental of understanding whether the electronic properties of the porphyrin complicity can be used for excitant coupling, and because theoretically, strictly consider, you can consider porphyrin as a circular oscillator when the linear oscillator is the proper electronic structure that can be applied to for excitant coupling. But the model studies and theoretical study has shown in this work published about 10 years ago that if there is a free rotation around the bond connecting the porphyrin plane with the aromatic group, so there is a free vibration. In this case, this degenerate transition can be simplified by so-called effective transition moment. And in this, for qualitative studies, you can consider that such chromophore can be viewed as a chromophore having effective transition moment in position 515, because the opposite should be canceled because of the free vibration. Therefore, this has been also tested and proven as correct. If you have a single porphyrin, this is here the steroid containing one porphyrin, you have negligible CD effect. Nobody can do anything for analysis with single porphyrin because asymmetrization of the porphyrin as a chromophore is negligible by this chiral steroid skeleton. However, if you attach two porphyrin to the same molecule, another one in position 3, there is a situation when these two porphyrin comes as a twist. They form the twist unit, and the orientation of this 515 transition will give you a couplet which will reflect the stereochemistry, and this is actually shown. This this steroid is known for a long time ago. So therefore, this positive couplet confirms that there is a positive twist angle necessary requirement to have excitant coupling, and the distance is about 30 angstrom. So excitant coupling is phenomenon interaction between two chromophores when they are twisted to each other, their transition moment, and also they provide effect positive negative in this case reflecting the geometry of this the sign helicity of this twist. We have explored this enormous utility of the porphyrin by using this, as I said here, the steroid to determine the configuration of other steroids that have been not known before. Also, you attach the porphyrin to the nucleic oligonucleotide and study the interaction through the space of porphyrin when they are in the top. And when they, after hybridization, they form the helical twist. Interestingly, also we explore porphyrin with collaboration with Professor Roberto Purello when the porphyrin are very, very good sensor for conformational changes of DNA. We have found that porphyrin, for example, give very characteristic response, in this case negative effect, when there is a transition of B to Z conformation. This is a, and this in this case is non-covalent. This is a binding of the free porphyrin to the DNA as results of change of conformation and providing metalloporphyrin has bind to the exposed nitrogen in one of the nucleic acid. So this is work in ongoing, continual collaboration when we are having very interesting results of sensing conformational changes of B to Z. Here is one other case I'll tell you in a moment, when the porphyrin interacting, this is the close distance. This is interaction through the space. So this is excitant coupling between two transition moment, circle oscillator with considered simplified as a linear oscillator. Here, however, there is a short distance. This is a stacking between two porphyrin, and situation here is complicated. I show you example. There is a case when you take advantage of the metalloporphyrin as artificial receptor. So this is a unit of so-called tweezer, and when the porphyrin, metalloporphyrin in this case zinc, are attached to a chiral linker, in this case diol, this artificial tweezer become host for binding a molecule, chiral molecule, they have two groups to coordinate to the zinc. In this case, a chiral starting porphyrin tweezer turn to be chiral because host gas complex adopt twist orientation between the porphyrins. Okay, here is example when we have a long distance effect between the porphyrin. So this is one interesting example of study the configuration of one neurotoxin, gymnosin, when the hydroxy group here, after NMR analysis, has been shown they are syn-oriented. And we try to attach the porphyrin through sequence of chemical reaction, which require quite expert chemical derivatization, arriving to these two, this bis porphyrin derivative of this large neurotoxin containing more than 15 ether, polyether, one of the longest by that time when you did this 2005. And interestingly, the conformational analysis show that introduction of the porphyrin change the conformation of the ring when this second porphyrin is attached. So the J-ring goal conformational change as a result two porphyrin that in the beginning are expected to be seen, so there is no any twist between they, between should be no twist. They show twist about 30 degrees, which has been done by that time molecular mechanics and predicted and taking one configuration as arbitrarily chosen, and the experimental results show that positive effect is has been observed, positive couplet, and confirmed by DeVoe. So this is one example when the porphyrin have been found to be very effective for long distance interaction, long distance coupling. Sometime before this, we did analysis of the other neurotoxin, this was brevitoxin, when the distance was 50 angstrom. You observe couplet, which was non-symmetrical. The first band, which is here is shown, the first band, longer wavelength is stronger than the shorter wavelength. This was determined, as I said, before the gymnosin, and the distance from conformational analysis showed this porphyrin about 50 angstrom. But very recently, in 2012, Jochen Auchbach, in Buffalo University professor, has decided to prove, to check this, whether density functional theory can be applicable of the excitant coupling in long distance, and he interestingly find good results. He used DFT matrix method, and this paper is published in June this year, when he was able very closely to simulate this long distance coupling between the porphyrin. So I'll say that actually the excitant coupling now is attracting the theoretician. And of course, there are difficulties of this because the conformation of such molecule could be quite complicated. But he took our analysis for molecular model as a starting point, and then he optimized the geometry. Porphyrin are fascinating also because they can be very sensitive to interaction with biomolecule. Here I show you slide when the porphyrin has been attached to this brevitoxin bisporphyrin, and depending, and this is interaction with vesicle. This is unilamellar vesicles. When the porphyrin mix, bisporphyrin mix with this vesicles prepared from yolk, from fresh yolk, it's interact with a bilayer in different way. So the porphyrin can aggregate because they are the bisporphyrin brevitoxin aggregate, so they form channel into bilayer, and the CD is very weak. But this is the purpose to show that there is aggregation. When they are protonated, when the porphyrin is protonated, there is a repulsion, there is no CD. So let me see this case here. When you have pyridine porphyrin, which is more like hydrophilic, then you have a CD which is different from the hydrophobic, but still show that there is a formation of channel structure in this bilayer. And when protonation occur, because the porphyrin, pyridyl porphyrin are very repulsing, their CD disappear. See, this is an example to show that the porphyrin can be very good sensor for interaction of such system with biomolecule. And this is not because of the porphyrin. This is because it's a property of brevitoxin itself, because brevitoxin forms the channel based on the hydrogen bonding with the water, with the ether, with oxygen of the ether, cycle. Okay, so in case when the porphyrin is attached to DNA, as I mentioned in the beginning, and there is an interaction through the space, we have done also molecular dynamics simulation and have shown that when the porphyrin is metal porphyrin and the zinc porphyrin is hydrophilic, and in this case there is no interaction with the DNA, with an adjacent with the DNA. So the couplet is very strong. In this case you have strong in the low temperature because this is a very strong double strand. There is no destruction of the double strand. However, and this is the angle here, so this has been also shown by molecular dynamics simulation. There is a distance about 12 angstrom between the porphyrin and the vicinal basis. However, if you increase the polarity of the salt with a high salt concentration, we observe completely different picture. This double strand having porphyrin at the very end, they aggregate. So there are short distances between stacking between the porphyrin, and here comes the circular oscillator of porphyrin that has been studied in detail by Rino Pesitelli and Angela, the graduate student collaboration with Roberto Purello. And you found that this is a signature, and this is a general signature of the porphyrin when they are stacked. And they stacked and they form chiral, very short distance, about 3-4 angstrom, and they form slight, they have angle between this porphyrin planes. This is a very interesting study that several people participated, but this is a signature that you will see in many of the papers, also including in the studies of Bert Meyer when they study materials containing porphyrin. Okay, so this is a few work about the tweezer. I told you this is what you did before forming host gas complex. More recently, you collaborate with Tommaso Carofiglio from University of Padua, and you have developed this tweezer, actually synthesized by him, and you carry the choroptical studies. This is melamine-based tweezer, which gives other interesting response. So with the traditional tweezer that was studied before, commercially available, the principle is that when the host gas complex is formed, the larger group is preferred to take to be outside of binding pockets. This is kind of a cartoon of this. As a result, there is a conformation, of course, in solution, which can see different orientation between the two porphyrin. This is equilibrium. However, the most preferred should be this when the larger group is pointing down. As a result, the CD should be positive or negative depending on the configuration of host gas, host, in this case, this is hydroxybeta-lactam. So this reflects the configuration and conformational analysis, which has been carried by OPLS, developed by Jorgensen, predict which will be the preferred conformation of preferred porphyrin helicity depending on selected configuration. As you see here, the porphyrin works well. The amplitude CD amplitude is pretty large, it's 1,000. So this means that the porphyrin can be used successfully, so-called supramolecular approach, when you don't need to attach the porphyrin to chiral center, to chiral molecule, but use chiral, achiral receptor, porphyrin receptor, to sense the configuration of such small molecule when the, you can convert it into conjugate by simple chemical reaction. Okay, so let me tell, before I go to the Alina, I'd like to tell you something about very recent work that's just submitted. This is collaboration. I promised to tell you about the collaboration with my colleague and young researcher in Italy, and this is the case. This is a collaboration, already 2 years collaboration, with Professor Evidente, Antonio Evidente, University of Naples, and Professor Superchi, University of Basilicata, where you study the try to determine absolute configuration of natural product isolated from fungal and plant phytotoxins. I'll show you here this example with oxysporon only, because I would like here to briefly tell you that one method perhaps is not enough. You have to use several methods. Okay, so this is oxysporon. It seems that it's a simple molecule, but it's not that simple when it comes to calculate the properties, chiroptical properties. So this molecule, oxysporon, has a pickering of the AB ring. As results, after Monte Carlo and molecular dynamics and optimization, OPLS, and optimization after that with several bases at DFT, we arrived with five conformers, where these 50% and 42% are the populated. The other one is negligible. The UV, the optical rotation, is happened for the configuration chosen for the calculation. This is here shown. Show that calculation for this five conformer average is negative. It's negative. However, the optical rotation in two different solvents, chloroform and ethanol, show consistently opposite as the positive. This is important for ORD to have different solvent, because if you have a different solvent, you have different ORD, that's a bad, no, bad message. You have to be cautious and look for some deep, what is the reason. Because environmental factors are very sensitive. Optical rotation is very sensitive to environmental factor, the solvent. We measure for the same configuration optical rotation. It happened to be positive, and the calculated for this configuration happened to be opposite. So for these two methods, you come to the conclusion that the configuration should be opposite of this. Yes. However, we wanted to check the VCD, because VCD also for this molecule should be suitable method. And you measure VCD, this is natural, sorry, this is, yes, okay. Here, this is the measurements what you did. This is the oxysporon, which is calculated for optical rotation for the opposite configuration. Opposite configuration, and here, is the experimental. So this means that the optical, that configuration from optical rotation and electronic CD are giving right answer for such configuration. And this agree with the experimental. So this is inverted of the, which I showed, this configuration which is mirror image of the use for the other two methods. However, this is fine. However, you see here that there is a band here which remain here positive in the calculation, and here is negative. And we know now, actually, here has been a symposium in October when you discuss a lot about how you can consider VCD analysis reliable for configuration. And we try two different concepts. One was a concept of robustnesses that has been introduced by Berendt and Valentiniku. But we found that this conformational flexibility of this molecule is kind of making problems. So you try the other approach with the G factor, which has been suggested by Hungarian author. This is Magyar Falvi, and you, according which you can consider the VCD band reliable. Reliable for assignment if the G factor, so this means the ratio between rotational and magnetic dipole, rotational and dipole strength is above the borderline 10 ppm. You found here that most of the bands are above this. However, this band is not. And if I had to use only this spectra to determine configuration, I'll say that this conclusion VCD contains uncertainty. So as a result, the test of three methods show that ORD and CD give results in agreement, and the absolute configuration of oxysporon should be this. So this is a short discussion that the seemingly simple organic molecule can be actually more flexible and making problems than it seems in the first sight. Okay, so now I'd like to tell you a very few about. I perhaps did not mention here that the work of these natural products is done as a part of the PhD thesis of Giuseppe Mazzeo from the University of Basilicata in the group, the former group of Professor Carlo Rossini, who died, and now he is supervised in part of his thesis before he did this work by Stefano Superchi. So this is about this natural product. So the conclusion that I would like to make is that one method now, when you can use many chiroptical methods and more calculation, more sophisticated calculation, where the solvent effect can be taken into account. I did not mention here oxysporon VCD. We found that only implicit model gives result. Explicit was not taken properly. So that's also the problem. Which is better, implicit and explicit? I think you have discussed, Professor Baroni has discussed this in paper, so I don't. This is like Pandora box. If I start talking about this, maybe we'll have 100 questions here. All right. But we are trying as organic chemists to take seriously into account the theoretical results, the new concept, and therefore this is the only way I think you can move synergetically to study more complex natural products and synthetic chiral compounds along with the developing and advancing theoretical methods. Although there is no middle way. Okay, so here is briefly actually about the chiral aline compounds. Alines are very interesting first natural products. They have fascinated chemists for a long time. There are a lot of pheromones containing chiral aline. This means when the terminal carbon, sp2 carbon, contain two different chromophores. In this case, there are no symmetry plane, and they are chiral. So in a completely different setting, in collaboration with Professor François Diederik Ettehaar in Zurich, you study several chiral several type chiral compounds. I tell you briefly in the next few slides. First, this is the 1,3-diethylenylalanines. When you have alene chiral here, you have triple bond and you have chromophore dimethylamino group, aniline. And then when there is a complex, you have tetracyanobutadiene microcycle and you have also oligomer. So the synthesis has been performed in the group of Professor Diederich. So you arrived for, you had for analysis this compound, which is diethylenylalanine. And here, actually this compound is not stable, it's photoracemized daylight, so that has been taken carefully into account when it was purified. But interestingly, here you have several chromophore. You have phenyl, you have triple bond, you have aline, so it will be naive to apply only excitant chirality method to such molecule, because when you have several chromophores with different transition, it has to be proven carefully, the type of transition, polarization, and so on. Therefore, we did two different ways. So this was actually done by excitant chirality, which is by using the protocol, this is the Professor Harada, who is one of the first person who developed this method for organic chemistry. So this is dipole velocity method. And you found that experimental CD calculated, agree quite calculated. The conformation has been this molecule has been optimized from X-ray and found to be very close to actually the X-ray. And the angle between these two phenyl, substituted phenyl, about 120 degrees. The calculation has been also carried out by using TDDFT. This is the law of basis set 6, 3, 1 G star, and you found 20 transition, and you found that taking into account of 20, and you found that this calculation also agree with some shift with the experimental CD. So this is here parallel analysis of one molecule containing several chromophore. Through doubt about applicability of excitant coupling, and therefore we repeat it with TDDFT. So in this case was okay, the results was configuration has been shown to be M configuration negative 120 degrees. One very interesting problem arose when the this molecule has been extended with this arm here with tetracyanobutadiene. Okay, so this is here here is the core. This is aline, which contain butyl group, and here it's of course by synthesis, which is click type synthesis. Has been also performed in Professor Diederich group. We arrived to tetracyano butadiene, which have posed one interesting question. Is it possible that highly substituted aline, you have here butyl, T-butyl, T-butyl, and this highly bulky arm, is it possible to transfer chirality from aline to here so that there will be slight preferred rotation around the CC sigma bond, okay, sigma bond. And the X-ray here has shown the orientation of this arm with regard to the aline. This is 90 degrees. This is not surprising, but what about here? So you measure the CD, here there are two from two enantiomer, either peak configuration or M configuration, and you had this in two different enantiomer, and they gave different mirror image CD spectra. How you will prove that here there is a so-called chiral induction? Whether there is a conformational preference of the angle between angle between this substituent as results of effect of chiral allele, and it was impossible. We found that the only way was to do analysis by changing here potential energy surface by to study by systematic variation by 60 degrees the angle here, as I mentioned in the previous structure. Okay, so we by doing this we arrive with 15 conformers which have a different energy. So the PS surface show that there is one here which are shown with the star, which is the lowest energy conformer. So what else? So when we look into this, we found that the geometry of this conformer is such that there is a uniform twist between this in this CC bond. It's about 70 degrees plus here and plus here. And all conformers, their remaining 15 conformers, they are either having the same negative-negative or negative-positive or so, but they are also in the high energy, and also they have a very different CD profile when this was calculated. So we have calculated this conformer that showed the low energy, and you found that there is a quite good agreement, of course not ideal agreement, but the shape of the band and the sign of the band agree with for the lower conformer with this experimental theoretical. So we have proven that the preferred is positive orientation, and in a sense there is a chiral induction between these two tetracyanobutadiene as results of chirality of the allene. But somebody now may realize that you may be very wrong, because this may be due of interaction between two different chromophore, this tetracyanobutadiene. So you did also truncated model, okay, and you calculated, and you saw that here there is a disband comes from the fact there is a chiral twist. Okay, so I take you 5 more minutes. I'm sorry, I spoke too long. In the case when you study the macrocycle, the synthesis also follow this the procedure by palladium catalyzed oxidative homocoupling, and we arrive when you start with a racemic, you arrive with 4 different diastereomers. So they are racemic, which are called crown conformation, twist conformation, and there is a 2-echiral chair and bout conformation. We study, this has been separated by HPLC, and this is here shown, these 4 different diastereomers. Okay, so this MMMM crown chiral, and this this is which is twist also chiral. They have different shape of the molecule, different macrocycle, and they show different properties. I believe you cannot see here; it's very weak. But believe me, I should tell you that chiral crown macrocycle has outstanding properties. MM show very strong here positive and negative, and PP show negative and corresponding positive, while the PPPM, which is twist, gives much weaker band. So this is outstanding response of the D4 symmetry of the chiral crown macrocycle. And more importantly, crown microcycle is more intense about 100 times than the monomer. So here there is a non-linear effect. See, here the crown conformation provides something which has been rationalized by analysis of electric and magnetic dipole moments. And it has been shown that the crown, in this case that you show here, the negative PVP, has a very strong magnetic moment, weak electric transition moment, which is in the plane of the cycle here. As a result, the G factor for the macrocycle crown conformation is outstanding, very much larger in this band. I should say also here, I selected this example because I wanted to show that in this very interesting theoretical study has been very, very much involved Fabrizio Santoro. Without him, we could not go so deep, and I would like to thank you also for this. We have been studying here the vibronic structure. We came to certain conclusion about this, but as Fabrizio could tell, if there is a question more, you could not come to calculation of the excited states so well. So this is, I believe, it's still preliminary, and this is open possibility for further studies. Also, I should say that we have tried different basis set in and only with the CAM BLYP we have the best agreement with the experimental. So this has been the long studies, I mean long in time, but extended studies, and I think we are quite satisfied with that this study is open possibility for further studies. And I think this is good to know that one study is good if you open the door. If the study closed the door, that's a different story. Okay. This is about the very last portion, a few slides. When we studied, this is the oligomer. We started with tetramer, and octamer, and sixtamer. We found this, again, by homocoupling. So this has been studied by electronic circular dichroism and by optical rotation. And we found here, again, nonlinear effect. We found that this is oligomer that monodisperse, so they have one molecular weight. They are not mixture of different oligomers. So why we have CD which is not linear? Is it possible that this oligomer are not long chain, but they form some second element of chirality, which is twisting helical structure? Because we observe that with the raising, increasing the number of the monomer, this nonlinearity becomes even clearer and clearer until it comes to saturation between 8 and 6 and 16. So we plotted here also G factor, and you've also found that this is something that contributes. There is not only chirality of allele. And more clear data comes from optical rotation. Optical rotation by theoretician is usually ignored. I should encourage you not to neglect optical rotation, because optical rotation could be quite revealing in addition to other chiroptical data. And you see here that this is a rotation which changes non-linearly. You hear this value has to be 16 times more than this, but it's not. It's much higher. So this is why, because we found after, again, here it was impossible, the way, again, variation of the angle. So you postulated that if there is a slight rotation here between the bond of this, you may see formation of helical structure with a certain angle. Maybe this will be a angle will be uniform in the whole, in the entire chain. And when you study the smaller, the shorter, you found that you cannot predict predict what is the preferred twist between this unit. We come to the very broad guessing between 0 and 135, plus 35. However, when you went to the higher oligomer, you found that you can narrow the range of the possible angle. And this is also here proven by calculation of optical rotation considering this variation of the angle. And you see here when you have this tetramer, you see that it's, I believe you cannot see but very well, but this is when you have experimental with a bright green, and the close to this is this, which is about 45 degrees. When you calculated CD, electronic CD, for 45 degrees twist of this helical oligomer, we found a good agreement. This is experimental. Here, which I believe you cannot see. There is a vibronic structure here, and this is the other is calculated. Okay, so in this case, we are coming close to conclusion that in this case we have also induction, chiral induction, as results the polymer, the oligomer adopt not straight, but adopt helical twist between aline, chiral aline, and we believe also this also can be called as a foldamer, which comes somehow share similarity with nucleic acid peptide. And one explanation could be also the increase of entropy, because when you have excluded of the solvent, when you have helical structure, part of the solvent is out. So you have restriction of the release of the solvent outside the oligomer, because when it's folded. When it's folded, there is less solvent involved. Therefore, there's increase of entropy, if you want to look in this way. So, this is my last before the last. Okay, so with this I'd like to summarize that this long way of study of a macrocycle and oligomer show us that there is a chiral induction and formation of well-defined conformation solution. In this case that I just presented, foldamer. And interestingly, when you compare this with a macrocycle, amazing effect. Sensitivity of electronic circular dichroism to the shape. You have the same number of the chromophore in the tetramer oligomer, and you have here the red shown here, positive and negative CD. In the same number of chromophore when they form the cycle, macrocycle, you have negative CD. So this is a good explanation, a demonstration, I believe, for the high sensitivity of electronic circular dichroism to molecular shape. So this is about the conformation. Okay, with this I would like to come to the most important slide. So the people they have been shown in purple are my very dear colleague, young scientists, Alexandro Setter. We're working with Professor Tommaso Carofiglio from Padova. This is Alessandro Urso. It's alphabetical, so it's a graduate student, and he spent time, this is the people they spend time in Colombia, with Professor Roberto Purello. You work on non-covalently interaction between the porphyrin and DNA, and this work is continuing. You have Egidio, who was graduate student of the late Professor Carlo Rossini, who also spent time in Colombia. You're working on other problems like calicheamycin, very important antibiotic. And here comes Angela Mamana, who worked together with other people, including Gennaro, on the DNA, DNA that I show you, it's stacking and non-stacking. Giuseppe Maseo is just work on the natural products with Professor Evidente, and he spent about less than a year in Colombia last year working on these natural products. I would like to mention specifically Rino Pesitelli, with whom after he spent 1 year in Colombia, you continue to collaborate, and I cannot think to stop. And I wish you continue for further and further, because this proliferation of this work in Pisa on electronic CD, solid state CD determined, simulated by TDFT, is something new horizon and area of application of Kerr optical spectroscopy. Of course, I cannot stop here mentioning Tommaso, this Roberto Corradini, you work on, actually Alessandro said I make mistake, is working with Roberto Corradini. Tommaso Carofiglio is the melamine tweezer. Lorenzo is always continuing collaboration, and you wish to continue for many years to come. Antonio Evidente, natural products. Roberto, I say already. Carlo Rossini unfortunately died. Fabrizio, again, thank you for analysis and future. Stefano Superchi and Riccardo Zanasi, you did also analysis of electronic CD and optical rotation of some compounds that comes from the work with Egidio and Professor Carlo Rossini. So this is a part. There are other people they have left before this. We're in Colombia. Some of them are professors like Alfonso Mangoni. I worked with him a long time ago, and I wish that the people that work in Colombia, they continue successfully to work here. I would like to acknowledge all my senior colleagues that encourage the student to take this challenging project in collaboration with us. And of course, I am indebted also to all my colleagues, current and past student researcher and senior that has been participated in this study. Some of you, they know Koji Nakanishi. He has been also involved in many other, many projects by encouraging and advising kids never to afraid to take a challenging project, because the development of science comes when you take something very challenging. And I thank you for your attention. And once again, I thank you for this great honor. I'm humbled to get it. I hope I have not disappointed you in this lecture. Thank you very much.
I would like to remember a very old use of a coupling in the benzene chromophore. Just for the coupling, we demonstrate that isotactic polymer polypropylene is spiralized in solution like in the solid states. If we copolymerize few a small quantity of styrene with propylene, we can see a very nice coupling of a benzene chromophore. And this was, following your indication, one of a very nice demonstration of a spiralized chromophore.
Thank you. Thank you.
I can make a comment. What is, I mean, in these very complicated structures with so many chromophores, like the macro, the alenoacetylenic one, yeah. I mean, the problem with the theoretical simulation of ECD is that you have a dense bath of electronistase. So you, in principle, you have to go for a complete non-adiabatic approach to the ECD. For example, in the specific case you were mentioning, we had something like 10 electronistates in 0.5 eV. In such a situation, you have so many almost degenerate electronistates that you cannot think that a single state approach can give you a full answer. And this is, I think, a bottleneck, because having such a approach is something that will
this
require.
This is the purpose for theoretician, because this is something that will drive the development of the theory, yes? Non-adiabatic, exactly, yes. So therefore, I said in the beginning, the synergism, you have organic chemist, natural products isolate with a more sophisticated method, isolated complex natural product. Synthetic people synthesize, like the group of Professor Diederich, fantastic synthesis, okay? So this means that the various fields of research related to theoretical study in chirality are advancing, therefore they are giving new, more and more challenging task. Okay, when they isolated complex natural products, the spectroscopists have to find out which method works. Theoretician has to see which method, how they can take into account environmental factor, as you say, this higher level of calculation. Okay, I did not show you one of these single example of this Professor Evidente natural products when none of the tested theoretical method was able to predict optical rotation. I talked to Daniel Crawford, and Daniel Crawford wants to have this molecule to try to see the couple cluster, because it's amazing. It's a kind of mystery why this is not possible, so single molecule, to predict the optical rotation.
Point, of course, because we too would like to have the same molecule, because we have different ideas about the driving factors,
okay,
explaining the difference between theory and experiment.
Okay.
And especially Chiara, I think, has some ideas about environment, about anharmonicity and so on, so that we would like to have a test.
Very good. It's also on the slide, but I didn't talk
about
this.
Course.
This is cytolite with a double bond.
But,
methyl group give perfect agreement. When you have double bond, let's...
We are really curious about seeing different effects. So
yes, all right.
Sorry for the intervention, but
no, that's
as
that,
I
that's
mentioned, I cannot resist.
No,
so.
that's the purpose. That's the purpose to show something that doesn't work for us and maybe work for you.
Other questions?
Staying on this very same molecule, is CD
which
also,
same molecule?
Molecule Matteo's, let's
oh,
call it
okay,
that
shall
way.
I go there?
Molecule, no. Is electronic CD also changing a lot with conformation? Where among the six different conformations?
Electronic CD is pretty well agreement, and the CD, the optical rotation can be found out that is agreement ORD with the theoretical only when you go with a reconstruct optical rotation from CD using Kronig-Kramer equation. That's only this
and,
way.
If so, can we, in a way, extend the concept of robustness of Kerr optical information? So Kerr optical information should not only be strong in compared to total absorption, but also be robust with respect to the conformational distribution.
Get it exactly. You mean for the electronic CD or VCD?
Robustness was introduced for VCD.
Yes.
Which is extremely sensitive to conformation.
Yes.
In the context of electronic CD, we can probably, in a way, enlarge the concept of robustness.
Yes, but this is a big question, because if you have conformer, if you have 8 conformer, for example, and they have different CD profile, it comes the next question, how sure you are in the determination of the population of the conformer.
Right.
Okay, so we are only sure at the moment when it seems the picture is simple. You have the conformer, you have 5 conformer, you have one which is like 70%, the other is 25%. You say, oh, Boltzmann gave you 95%. And number one, number two conformer have pretty similar. So you are sure. But if you have this conformer have different profile in the CD and also optical rotation, positive, negative, okay? You have different conformer show different ORD curve. And so you have to go back and do your work to take environmental factor, and this is open there. What is this solvent doing? Is the solvent affecting only the conformational equilibria, or is affecting the properties? So that's, I think, now you are quite certain in the narrow field. And if you want to go outside of this setting, you have to look in the theoretician. So...